Throughout the first half of the Middle Ages in Europe, the works of Aristotle and of most Greek philosophers had been completely forgotten and forsaken, while Plato's work would go on to be celebrated. The works of St. Augustine advocating for an allegorical interpretation of scripture, as well as an evolution of life, had been completely forgotten as well. What was left were Platonic and biblical views regarding the creation of the universe and life, but these were largely the same. They both described a divine creation and that life was unchanging, and as the church had hegemony over all of Europe, there was nearly no room for evolutionary thinking during this age of intellectual darkness in Europe. However, east of Europe, a beacon of intellectual innovation shined bright in the Arabian world. This was the Islamic Golden Age. The Arabian world was the hub of science and philosophy. Today, if you wish to read scientific papers, you must first learn the language they are published in, the English language. Well, during the Islamic Golden Age, Arabic was that language. Arabic was the language that science was conducted in. While Europe had lost and forgotten much of the works of Aristotle, the Islamic world translated it. The surviving works of Aristotle that we have today could have been completely lost if it was not for the Islamic Golden Age, where his writings were translated from ancient Greek to Arabic. Not only were the works of Aristotle translated, but the works of many thinkers from classical antiquity were translated as well. This included the ideas of Empedocles and Anaximander. While Europe had no access to the evolutionary ideas of these thinkers, the Islamic world did. The Arabian scholar Al-Jahiz wrote about a struggle for existence-like concept in his work, Book of Animals. In sum, no animal can survive without nourishment. The hunting animal cannot escape being hunted. Every weak animal devours those that are weaker. Every strong animal cannot avoid being consumed by those that are stronger. God, in sum, made some beings the cause of life to others, and in turn made these the cause of death to yet others. Al-Jahiz believed that the environment, paired with the competition for resources, was responsible for the kinds of characteristics he saw in animals. He even went on to describe that this was the case for humans as well. He believed that the environment in which different human populations lived contributed to the difference in skin color and different physical characteristics that he saw in them. Al-Jahiz thought that the environment and the actions an animal took to survive directly influenced its offspring to become more adapted to the environment. For example, a cheetah needs strong and fast leg muscles in order to catch a gazelle. The cheetah needs to use his or her legs to survive and compete for resources, so the cheetah's leg muscles will be used constantly throughout his or her life. The cheetah's leg muscles get stronger and faster the more he or she uses them, and these faster, stronger leg muscles are then passed down to his or her offspring. The baby cheetah will then use his or her leg muscles extensively, and his or her offspring will inherit these leg muscles. After many generations, every cheetah will have stronger and faster leg muscles than the cheetahs in generation 1 because leg muscles are extensively used to help cheetahs survive. Al-Jahiz's thoughts on evolution could be best described as a proto-Lamarckian concept of evolution. Al-Masudi was an Islamic historian who occasionally wrote about events so distant in the past that they transcend the historical timescale, making their way to the timescales of cosmology, evolutionary biology, and geology. He espoused a kind of evolution that started with simplicity and gradually produced complexity. He thought that the fundamental elements evolved into more complex elements into plants, plants into animals, and animals into humans. The 10th century scholar Al-Nakhshibi thought the same way. He writes, "While man has sprung from sentient beings, these have sprung from vegetal beings, and these in turn from combined substances, these from elementary qualities, and these from celestial bodies." Another Islamic historian by the name of Ibn Khaldun also articulated an evolutionary timescale in his seminal work, Muqaddimah. Creation started out from the minerals and progressed in an ingenious, gradual manner. To plants and animals, the last stage of minerals is connected to the first stage of plants, such as herbs and seedless plants. The last stage of plants, such as palms and vines, is connected to the first stage of animals, such as snails and shellfish. The last stage of each group is fully prepared to become the first stage of the next group. Al-Tusi shared with Al-Jahiz a proto-Lamarckian theory of evolution, and he shared with Al-Masudi an evolutionary timescale, where elements evolved into plants, plants into animals, and animals into humans. However, he went a step further than Al-Masudi did on the evolution of humans. Al-Tusi believed that humans likely evolved not just from any advanced animal, but from the primates in Africa, due to our physical and anatomical similarities with them. This predated Darwin's out-of-Africa hypothesis by 600 years. Unfortunately, due to the siege of Baghdad by the Mongols, and due to the changing relationship between theology and science occurring in the Islamic world, and many other factors, intellectualism and innovation stagnated, and so did the evolutionary ideas. In the 12th century, the works of Aristotle and other Greek and Roman philosophers, and the Islamic philosophers, made their way to Europe by the production of Arabic to Latin translations of the text. Despite all this, little to no significant postulations on evolutionary theory occurred for the rest of the Dark Ages. Taking both Plato's and Aristotle's works, Thomas Aquinas developed the Great Chain of Being. In this chain, theological beings, living beings, and even some inanimate objects are ranked from highest to lowest. God at the top, angels beneath him, humans above the animals, animals above the plants, plants above the rocks and other inanimate objects, and hell at the bottom. Everything on this chain had a fixed, or immutable position, leaving little to no room for evolutionary thinking. However, while most High Middle Age scholars in Europe believed in the immutability of species, some, like Albertus Magnus, were open to the idea of the emergence of new species from certain original types. For example, perhaps a lion and a tiger both emerged from a single original type of big cat. This idea was largely influenced by Aristotelian metaphysics, specifically by Aristotle's concept of potentiality and actuality. Let's say I have the potential to become an actor. If I choose to go to acting school and take it seriously, I can take this potential of mine and make it an actual or a reality. However, I cannot run at 50 miles an hour, no matter what actions I take, because running 50 miles an hour is not something that is in human potential. The originally created cat of Genesis had the potential to give rise to new kinds of cats, like tigers, lions, panthers, and bobcats, but they were still cats in the end. Cats did not have the potential, however, to slowly change into completely different kinds of animals, like dolphins or fishes or gorillas, so this could not become an actual. Well, that pretty much sums it up for the evolutionary ideas of the Middle Ages. In part 3, I'm going to be going into the evolutionary ideas during the Renaissance, so if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like and subscribe for more content. Thanks!